Welcome back, everybody, to the Sina Cup. We're going to be getting into Game 3 of LV Gaming versus HGT. Now, there's some interesting things that are already happening in the draft. So, LV Gaming. Ugh, Jesus. LV Gaming went ahead and left open a Death Prophet. And it seemed like they fully understood what they were doing here because they left open the Death Prophet. HGT took a little bit of time figuring out whether or not they truly wanted that as their first pick. And the moment it happened, LV Gaming instantly responded with the Razor, Skywrath Mage, insta pickups. HGT then went ahead and grabbed the Tidehunter for themselves. Again, we were talking about the big AoE disables that work really well for the Death Prophet. The Faceless Void as well as the Tidehunter are the two of the best ones. And despite the fact that Tidehunter has already been picked up by HGT, we're going to see Faceless Void banned out anyway by LV Gaming and also going to take away that Mirana. While the Earthshaker and Enigma are going to be banned out by HGT. They had some issues with the Enigma last game, as well as game one, actually.
Sand King.
So it's no surprise, but LV Gaming actually, for the first time, get their Sand King, which they've been trying to pick up the last few times. HGT have actually banned away in the second banning phase. So it really hasn't been available to HGT. Centaur Warrunner is now going to be grabbed. Is this going to be in one position Centaur? HGT looking to be grabbing a very aggressive lineup here with a one position Centaur, an offlane Tidehunter, and a mid Death Prophet, making our Death Prophet the hardest carry on the side of HGT. And I feel like maybe this is... this is showing their cards a little bit too early. Of course, if you look at this in the same light, HGT also needed to be able to grab the Centaur Warrunner for fear of LV Gaming getting it themselves. They still kind of need an offlaner. Now they're going to grab their mid. With the Viper pickup, Ancient Apparition, once again grabbed by HGT. We saw a lot of success about that. A lot of success from the Ancient Apparition in... And game number two, countered the Viper really well multiple times.
10 seconds remaining. Radiant team ban.
So the last couple of bans here, LV Gaming, there still needs to be, there still needs to be another support. I don't really think Lion was my idea of the support for HGT. I'm hoping to see something a little bit more active, but... they went ahead, banned away the Lion. Meanwhile, HGT, they need to ban away an offlaner here. And I'm thinking Clockwork might be the Reserve best time. Offlaner that's still left in the pool. Doom, Faces Void, Centaur. All those heroes are already out of the pool, whether banned or picked up. I'm trying to think if they're... well, okay, the Furion, but I guess that's in anticipation of some split push. But they had the Centaur, who should be in one position here, which means a fast Blink Dagger. I don't really see them having too much issues with split push from the Centaur, from the Furion, honestly. But they went ahead and took it away anyway. Which leaves, I would say the Clockwork personally, he's a really great frontline holding hero that is going to be able to set up heroes like the Sand King and Razor to be able to get off really good ultimates. He's also a quick blade mail hero, probably, and will be able to deal a lot of damage back to many of the heroes on HGT. Probably won't be surviving anytime soon in these engagements, but that's fine. And taking the rest of their reserve time to be able to determine this last pick. I honestly, my head is just going to blank. Timbersaw is a possibility here. You have two big strength heroes, so Timbersaw is, I guess, viable. But part of the problem with Timbersaw is you don't know what other support is going to be up against you in that offlane. So if they have a really good harassive lane, like, if they have any sort of disables from a support,
10 seconds
and
remaining.
Then that's long enough disables for the Centaur to come in and hit a host stomp, like, you're done for.
Clockwork!
And Clockwork it is.
Radiant team pick.
I was just trying to rack my head there of offlaners, and I really just couldn't think of anything that would really be that viable.
So finally, the Clockwork is going to be settled on. Zyph is actually going to be playing that one in Flame on the Razor, and that leaves Lin picking at the Viper now. Rubick going to be the last pickup here for HGT. I can't say I'm too surprised about that one. I was already thinking about the Rubick. He's a good combination here with the Ancient Apparition. He's also a really good setup for the Centaur. And the important thing is, look how many great abilities you have to steal. You have the Guaranteed Viper Strike whenever you want it.
Prepare
Burrow Strike.
For battle.
Incredibly, incredibly strong for Rubick to steal. You have the Skywrath Mage's various abilities, all strong in their own regards. Clockwork. Maybe a steel hookshot or a cogs. Not the worst idea in the world. So the Rubick is going to have a pretty fun game this time around. Not any big time, like, game-changing ultimate steals, but a lot of pretty damn good abilities for the Rubick nonetheless. Now the smoke rotation is going to be able to run into demons, and they will not be able to get the telekinesis. LV are still mounting a bit of response, but they won't have their last here, which is the Clockwork. So the early ward is going to be placed here to block out this hard camp.
30 seconds.
They're trying to put a stop to the Sand King jungling up. At the same time, Magic Bush Ward has already been placed by the Clockwork, so he's going to be able to block out both of these camps. So got it. And are they actually going to be doing this? It looks like HGT want to run themselves in dual lanes. Rubick's going to be babysitting the Tidehunter. We're going to be left with ZSMJ and S going up against the offlane Clock. I have to say, I kind of think they need the telekinesis here up against Clockwork, as telekinesis one of the being the better abilities to pull Clockwork out of the cogs. I'm not so sure how wise it is just to put one support up against him. You can see Zyph is doing that cog blocking bit. He didn't successfully force the creeps, many of the creeps into the side lane. It's just going to be one, that one melee. Still, it will be enough for the lane to push forward, and that's all he was really looking for anyway.
Oh.
So Rubick is going to come back down to the bottom lane, it looks like. He just took some time at the top lane, but eventually he will be back. Does have double counters, so he should be able to free up this block, as the Magic Bush, as strong as it is, it's very obvious when it does this. And oh, Pretty Hot's actually going to be going for this pull. So for those of you guys who don't know, it happens 57 seconds. 57 and 27, you go ahead and telekinesis the creep, and he will run down through this way. And if you take one of the big creeps, they will survive through all of that damage from the Tier 2 tower. And you'll just be able to pull the creep wave all the way into the hard camp. And then maybe even pull that from the hard camp into the medium camp. Either way, you're going to get yourself a lot of extra experience, a lot of extra gold that you wouldn't normally expect. And it's a good way to shut down this offlaner. As you can see, Clockwork is now going to be forced forward as the lane pushes in. The beautiful thing about this one is that you can actually make this transition go all the way around to these different camps. Clockwork, oh, this is very ballsy. He tries to go for the Ancient Apparition. Doesn't catch him inside the cogs, but at least he burns out both of those heroes with the burn anyway. But watch this creep wave, right? He goes from the hard camp to the medium camp. Now the creeps will go back down straight into the hard camp area, where if it wasn't for the Magic Bush, he would be able to get an additional pull. Like, you just get so much experience when you're able to make these kind of rotations. Pretty Hot will now kill that ward, though. Now the Clockwork is going to be suffering. Tidehunter is able to really abuse the fact he's on the Radiant offlane, so he can take advantage of this camp he's got right here. Meanwhile, the Sand King is going to be farming up, trying to get to that first level 3 blood. Sandstorm, and we have our Clockwork. It gets picked off.
Many bloodies.
Telekinesis into a hoof stomp, followed up by a double edge, and we miss the first blood.
CS in the mid lane, 11-3, 11-2. It is a back and forth race between LV Lin and HGT's Kaka.
Dire's bottom tower is under attack.
Uh-oh, Zyve, don't tell me he's going to die again. He'll stomp into the full feet with the double edge. Once again, he dies. And this is actually really bad. That first death wasn't that big of a deal, solely because of the fact that a lot of experience was going to be flowing in due to the creep wave pushing, but when he dies a second time like this, not only is he feeding so much extra gold to the side of HGT, but we also have all this experience completely lost, as the clockwork wasn't there to soak it up. I would say before, and this is something that Bulba was saying, how there can be good deaths from an offlaner. Now, for sure, that first death from the clockwork wasn't a good death, but he was still going to make some gains off of it until he died a second time and wasn't able to get any of that experience that was pushing in. Ancient Apparition going to be fortunate enough to find himself in his room. Meanwhile, Tidehunter is dealing with a dual lane that is a little dangerous. The Razor just being such a good harassing hero in general, so he's going to be going ahead and trying to do some jungling. He stacked up the Ancients. We also, at the same time, have LV looking for a pickoff. Skywrath Mage and Sand King are going to be sitting on the side here, trying to look for that opening to gank Kaka. Won't be finding it, though. Kaka seems to be pretty aware of what's going on, despite the fact he doesn't have any vision up there in that top area. And instead is just going to sit back and wait for Lin to push in the wave. Bottom lane, more experience coming in for Zyve to take up, but he's got to be paranoid about getting too close to this Rubick. Cog's being thrown out just to be able to block out the creeps a little bit. But again, like, pretty harsh is going to run past the tower, and if Clockwork's close enough to be hit by telekinesis, he's close enough to die. The teleport in is going to come from the Razor here. They're going to try to force a full-out final. Silence onto the Centaur, stops the hoof stomp. In flame, well, they've already claimed the one kill on the Rubick. Doesn't look like they're going to get anything else out of this. And that's good enough. Would have been nice if they had been able to claim the Tier 1 tower, but as it is, the Razor's rotation, not really that valuable. For the side. Bottom lane, looks like they're going in again, catching out the clockwork.
Your name shall be
and
forgotten.
ZSMJ, with that very, very early blink dagger, surprises the offlaner once again. Picking up a blink dagger before you have a level 6 stampede is pretty legit for a centaur. But now he's got kind of everything he needs. He may not have gotten the early tranquil boots, which will make him a bit tough to be able to have that kind of genuine sustain, but he'll get it eventually. The most important thing is having that quick blink dagger and beginning to snowball. HGT rotation into the mid lane. ZSMJ with a smoke. Is looking for initiation, will be able to catch out Lin. Exorcism also going to be used, and the slow is not going to be good enough. ZSMJ getting a little low, but DDC is going to be chased down by Kaka, as the Exorcism does a good amount of damage, but DDC will survive at the end of the day. And Kaka is now just going to focus on trying to do as much damage to this Tier 1 tower, that Centaur rotation. He does go back off of it, but he's going to be able to get his Tranquil Boots, which is pretty damn big. Tranquil Boots plus a TP scroll. And he can actually go top lane if he wants to and continue to just shut out the clockwork entirely and make sure he doesn't pick up a fast level 6. Or he goes into like the middle lane once again. And goes for a pickoff, this time on Unflame. Hoofstomp lands, double edge finishes him off. And a dominating spree for ZSMJ. 7.5 minutes into this game, he is already sitting on top of 4 kills and 1 assist. Being a part of every single kill that has happened so far. Pretty hot, well, at least he knows there's vision here now.
My poison will
Not really the exact way you want to find out, but hey, at least he knows it.
Denied.
Centaur again, sitting here in this middle lane. Kaka does not have an exorcism this time around, so they need to be able to loosen up Lin's health points a bit more if they want to try and go for that kill. That's why ZSMJ is going to go top instead, looking for one of those pickoffs. They do have the Tidehunter, who's got himself a Ravage up, ready to go. Jump in, Centaur Hoofstomp is going to miss, and Scythe, who actually cogs back, and now they're going to try and turn this around. Scythe does have a hook shot, actually not going to be using it here. Ravage goes off, hitting on three. HGT will manage to get themselves farther down. Hoofstomp goes out, missing once again from ZSMJ. And Flame turning this one around, Ice Blast comes in. They're going to try and force these LV heroes back, but it's not going to be successful. And the Ice Blast just only hitting on that support, who does tick out at the end. He actually will shatter. Damage just kind of overwhelming him. Looks like the Clockwork is also going to be caught here. Hookshot goes out, but it's not going to be enough to save him. Kaka gets an additional kill. 7-2, HGT already taking a commanding lead here in game number 3. Also a pretty good fight there for Icy, who is halfway to his Blink Dagger now. Kaka, as the Exorcism is running out, he won't be able to get any damage on the tower. But they're still winning these team fights, and they do have... They certainly have the more aggressive early game-focused lineup, with their Death Prophet being their biggest core, but they are making all the right rotations. And if they can continue this pace, they'll easily be able to win this game about 25 minutes in.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
Razor gets himself a drums. No need for him to go mech. That's going to be on the side of the Viper. Yule Scepter is almost up for the Death Prophet, and that'll also be very helpful because the biggest fear right now is him being bursted down by the Sand King, who now has his level 6 with an epicenter. So if Sand King manages to get himself to level 8 and get an arcane boots in the next few minutes, Death Prophet is going to be continuously threatened. Smoke up behind the Viper right now. The rest of HGT are just sitting back and farming. They've got an Ice Blast ready to go. As soon as LV want to try and push uphill, they'll be met with that Shatter effect. Icy, though, is going to run into the heroes here of LV. The stun is going to be able to hold him in place. Still gets the immediate Kraken Shell proc. Plasma Field still going to be able to wipe him out with all that extra physical damage. Inflame will actually right-click down the Death Prophet very quickly there. And now they just need to get out, though. The Icy Ice Blast has already hit three heroes. ZSMJ coming in, locks himself in the trees. Okay. Lin says, hi, buddy. You having a good time in the trees? I don't think that was good enough for you. S is also going to get picked off, and this is pretty much a wipe. They lost every single hero here in the course of these events. Tidehunter is already backed up, but he was one of the first ones to die in the last team fight.
Radiant's bottom tower is under attack.
And now LV, well, seemed like things were going really well for HGT, and just one bad little pickoff there with the smoke from LV turning into a successful two or three heroes. Big pickup for them. Big, big pickup. Kaka, no exorcism. They will be able to deny the tower at the very least, so keeping some of that gold out of the hands of the side of LV, but they just lost that middle tier 1 tower. That is still a pretty critical map control tower. And to lose it this early on into the game, when you really should be the aggressors here, is not a good sign. Clockwork's going to jump in. Icy blown up by the Skywrath Mage Ultimate. Ice Blast's going to come in, hit on 2. With ZSMJ with the two-man hoofstomp and double edge on top of that one. Demon is going to be able to hit the stun onto the Centaur, finishing him off, and the rest of the team will back themselves away. 2-for-2 exchange. Not bad one way or the other. We lost the one position and the offlaner for HGT in exchange for the two position and offlane on the side of LV. Damage. So it was a pretty even team fight all in all, but I would say that goes into the favor of LV, just personally looking at that. Also helps that Demon got some critical experience there to be able to get his maxed out Burrow Strike and start getting to that level 2 epicenter, which makes a big difference. Items, items, items. Yule Scepter, definitely a must Dyer's here for Kaka, which means who's the mech going to be picked up by? Tidehunter. Tidehunter's not going to be going for the Ravage, the Blink Ravage. Instead, he's going to be depending on the Stampede in these early levels. And there's no issues with that. Exorcism will be able to finish off the tower soon. LV may be trying to go for the deny. They're going to try and actually jump in on Kaka. Cox backs him up with a Skywrath Mage open. Unable to lock him down. Now goes just the Ravage. Three heroes hit by that one with a beautiful Anchor Smash over the top. Lin will be taken down. Clockwork also falling, and nobody on the side of HGT actually loses their life, all because of the failed initiation from LV with the cogs not hitting the bouncing the Death Prophet away and the Skywrath Mage ultimate whiffing because of it. Well, stomp onto DDC and he just adds to the team fight. Was already so low, but actually Demons with a really good epicenter. If they can actually kill Kaka, he's already been Yule Scepter up the Razor. Razor trying to get in range of the plasma field, but Kaka is too fast for his own good.
Dyer's middle tower is under attack.
Little phase boots himself away. CSMJ looks like he wants to be a part of this fight. Stunning up Pro. Wow, he's going to get the kill on the Sand King. In fact, he may still be able to turn this around to some extent. He's able to hit the stun onto Zyph. Clockwork Rocket and just gets right-clicked down. I was hoping to see ZSMJ actually come in with the Hoof Stomp, but decides against it. Instead, is just going to play a bit more safer play. They still got a Rubick in exchange for a Sand King there, thanks to the great heads-up play of the Rubick. Stealing that Plasma Field was a very great decision. So now BKB next up for the Death Prophet. Dyer's once again, I feel like I'm flip-flopping back and forth, but start out, advantage for HGT, then LV managed to claw their way back in with a couple of big team fights. That was nice, but now I feel HGT are once again in control of this match after a bit of a hiccup earlier.
Dyer's top tower is under attack.
Smoke rotation, both Demons as well as DDC are going to be rotating to the top lane, where they are going to try and bait out Lin a little bit. Lin already has the mech, so he is fairly tanky. Dover is the Ice Blast, it makes it a lot more dangerous. Jump in, Clockwork is immediately going to go for Kaka. They hit the stun this time around, dropping the Skywrath Mage ultimate. Still not enough. At the same time, Zyph managed to get outside of his cogs. Kaka will be bursted down this time around. Demon going to be hit by the Hoof Stomp. Turn around, double edge. Not quite enough to finish him off. Burrow Strike not able to go off in time. ZSMJ, though, has nowhere to run. The cogs will be able to lock him in. And IC will also manage to get himself away. So two quick teleports will limit the effectiveness of that team fight for LV. Still, though, looks like LV are going to be in enough control to be able to take down this tier 1 tower in the top lane. 16-13, 16-30. Into this game.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
It's quite the roller coaster so far in gold and experience. HGT holding and vanishing gold while LV sneaking out on the experience battle. And Flame's going to be hit. Double stuns. They don't quite have enough burst damage, but maybe with the Ravage they do. Another Anchor Smash onto Inflame. Another right click, and he got it. That's a dominating streak down as Zyph also barely getting out there. Farther up, we do have the Exorcism going down from Kaka. Is able to finish off at least that one support, trying to catch up with the rest of the heroes, but HGT have won themselves a pretty good fight here. As the rest of LV will just be forced to back themselves up. Not sure if they really want to give up this tower or not, though.
Radiant's bottom tower is under attack.
Seems like LV is certainly ready to defend it, even though they've got two heroes dead right now. They've got a full-up Epicenter ready to go for the same team. Stampede, Epicenter beginning to go up with the Plasma Field. Will be able to stop him. The Blink Dagger, at the very least, still gets off a really good Burrow Strike.
that is going to be able to finish off the Rubick. CSMJ is low. But thinking about going back in, missed hook shot there. That could have been a great play. Burrow Strike is going to hit Icy. Trying to go back. Hook stomp lands on just one there. The Silence on two at the same time. Kanka and the rest of LV in some serious trouble. We have Sai throwing down the cogs. Plasma Field turnaround. And oh, what a Burrow Strike there from Demons. Hits three and will be able to get it, but loses life in the process. He gets the Ancient Apparition. Centaur diving in pretty deep here is going to lose his life to DDC as the last nuke will be able to finish him off. The Razor gets the Tidehunter on top of all that. So four hero kills and Death Prophet forced away with an exorcism he tried to use to finish off the Tier 1 tower. LV, just so much back and forth here. It's like one team manages to execute better in one team fight and they get an advantage. And then the next time around, it's the other team's turn. It just seems like this constant back and forth throw between the two teams of who is going to do better in the team fight. And I feel like that plays into LV's advantage, but it's hard to say. Kaka, how close is he to that BKB? He still needs a good amount of gold here, another 1,200. Nothing to scoff at, but if he can claim some of these Tier 1 towers, and that's why they're trying so hard to push down. But LV are routinely defending them. Even if they lose the fight, they're actually still pushing back HGT enough that they can't go for the towers. Centaur, Stampede going off. They're going to find Lin on the side. Already doing a lot of damage with that Ice Blast. They will be able to finish him off. Kaka already gets that on the right side, though. They all got the Centaur there as he tries to hide himself from the side. Yule Scepter onto the Sand King. And now Inflame actually comes in with this BKB, already draining away a lot of the damage away from Kaka, and is going to chase this down. The Sand King should be able to get in range of the Blink Dagger. Burrow Strike soon on somebody, anybody. S is going to get that one. Icy. He teleports out, so BKB, a full BKB use in exchange for an Ancient Apparition. They also lost their tower at the same time that was actually killed by the creeps there. So HGT certainly got what they wanted out of that team fight.
Radiant's bottom tower is under attack.
So Midas, Drums, BKB, I mean, to some extent, I do like the skill build, as it makes him a pretty aggressive hero early on. This Midas is certainly the most interesting item for the Razor, but it is massively boosting his experiences. He's been a part of a lot of kills, plus this Midas. He is almost sitting at level 16 right now. Nothing to do but farm for now on the side of HGT. I'm looking at this and wondering what items they're going to need, because I really don't feel they can push this too much later up against the Razor, as he is already looking so damn strong thanks to that Midas and all the kills he's been a part of. But if he's able to get the Aghanims after this BKB, then we will make sure we see the Aghanims this time around. But if he manages to get that upgrade with a level 3 Eye of the Storm so early on into the game, I don't think HGT stand much of a chance. They go for the Smoke Gank. Not going to be finding anybody just yet, as LV are staying pretty well grouped together, and they could actually go for a smoke of their own as soon as they finish up this Ancients. That might be the plan. Never mind. No smoke on anybody, so they're just team doing Ancients. Good enough for them. It's a safe way to be able to farm up. No risk of being picked off in the process of doing so.
Heavy to your doom.
I like this. This aggressive Rune Ward. It's going to be able to see any rotations in from the side of HGT through the laning phase. If they can actually get some... So early control this Tier 1 tower, they should be able to see any of these rotations, but it looks like HGT are fine if they want to try and take that Tier 1 tower in the bottom lane.
they'll go ahead and lay claim to this tier 2 in the mid. Now the Stampede's going to go off. They only caught DDC here. Ice Blast will be able to finish off that squishy support here. At the same time, we have Lin going in deep up against a BKB'd up Death Prophet, who's not going to be taking any damage from that epicenter. Unfortunately, Ancient Apparition will. Now Kaka losing a lot of his damage. Once again, the Nuff in flame just right clicks him down farther into the right. Lin standing up against three heroes and winning the engagement is now in flame, has come in, provide that extra bit of damage. Looks like ZSMJ hit by the burrow strike, not quite enough damage though. ZSMJ looking to blink away, has the opening now, will blink up, does not have a TP scroll though, and if he chooses to hide here, he's going to be hiding for quite some time.
Invisibility.
So after a pretty clutch team fight there for the side of LV, once again, the Razor getting bigger and bigger. This carry, he's sitting at 3,800 gold. That is almost a straight up Aghanim's now. ZSMJ's just letting his Tranquil Boots do their work. I don't know. I'm just so surprised he hasn't tried to make an exit out of this just yet. Finally, he does blink down. He's going to be able to get himself out. He's got the Stampede, and he regened up a bunch from the Tranquil Boots. Makes sense. 24 to 22. 24 minutes in, and we have right now a 1,000 gold lead for the side of LV, and a pretty big experience lead on top of that. I wonder what CSMJ is going to be going for next after the pipe. He's already got the Blink Dagger for his staff. He's going to have a pipe. He is actually the second most farmed hero on his team. So where do you go from here? Do you just go from a straight heart? It actually gives you a good, decent amount of damage, increases your return damage as well. I think it'd probably be one of the better builds after the pipe is finished up. Meanwhile, our Death Prophet, while she has been wrecking face with this BKB, up against many of the magic dealers, the physical damage dealers still tell her a new one. So she needed to be able to get some armor, and that's where that plate mail is going to be able to help out. We're also expecting to see a Shiva's later on into the game, but for now, just the armor will have to do. Smoke up here from LV, a four-man smoke with the Razor still being visible here in the bottom lane. They do have Roshan up, which is a possibility for either team if they get a pretty good engagement.
Dire's middle tower is
under attack. They also have a gem on the Sand King. Holy crap, I didn't even notice that. Demons bought himself a straight-up gem very early on into this game, so they see the vision around the Roshan pit. And if they can get a pick off, jump in, they're going to go for Ancient Apparition first. If they pop him here, he actually managed to get the Stampede off, he's going to be able to get away. He doesn't have an Ice Blast just yet, but another few seconds, he will be able to turn that on. In Flame is going to go for pretty hot while sapping away a lot of damage away from Kaka. Stun onto ZSMJ. Can they actually burst him down? Ice Blast is going to come in. Hits on two, but the Force Staff up the cliff to get ZSMJ out. Meanwhile, In Flame finishes off the Rubik real quickly. Already lame claim to the Death Prophet, and they just keep on going for more. Demons lands the Burrow Strike onto S. Icy has nothing he can do, as he was holding onto a Ravage for quite some time there, but he was just too late to the team fight to really do much.
Radiant's top tower
and LV take out three heroes real quickly, and now we'll set up
Radiant's middle
set up camp here
attack
on this tier 2. There's nothing HGT can push them back with. And it seemed to start out really well. I mean, LV were going for that Ancient Apparition pickoff and rotated a lot of heroes. Committed quite a bit to taking him down, but they couldn't finish him off. And with the Stampede plus the heals, Ancient Apparition did get away long enough to be able to turn around and hit a pretty good Ice Blast, like three heroes. So honestly, I'm not quite so sure what went wrong. I think it was just Inflame being too damn big and being able to force the Death Prophet away from the rest of his team. Mass drawings on the map by our Clockwork. They still have that ward here in the bottom lane, but we do have HGT making a rotation here. But if they don't actually smoke right now, they're going to be seen. Yeah, they are going to be seen indeed. I believe that smoke was caught out. Sure enough, there goes the ping from the Viper. And the rest of HGT just simply back themselves up. No, it's not really worth trying to risk a bad smoke engagement. Better just dodge it entirely. Okay, double damage for ZSMJ Centaur. He's actually hitting for 214 damage a hit. Icy, meanwhile, is stealing the ancient stack here on the side of LV. Isn't a particularly big stack, so it's not too big of a deal. But it does give Icy an extra bit of gold to start investing into the refresher he's going to need. Both teams just five-manning wherever they can. Blink Dagger finished up by the Tidehunter. Jump in from the Clockwork. But he actually hit the Creep Wave. And Kaka will be fortunate enough to be able to get himself away. They'll still hug shot down, and maybe HGT can force this team fight. They're going to go for Inflame first. Exorcism going out. Stun. Ravage on top of that. Inflame gets popped. That's 1,000 gold. Going the way of the Rubik. Now Kaka in the middle of everyone with his BKB Exorcism out. ZSMJ trying to chase down demons on the side here. Sandstorm for a second. First Strike is up as well. Needs some distance to be able to get off his Blink. Gets up to the side, but no. Blink to a section where he just cannot escape, and HGT will surround him. And wow. He got a lot of gold from that team fight. All of a sudden, he went from just picking up his Force Staff to now having a full-up Blink Dagger. Pretty incredible stuff, and unfortunately, with the supports, like, the support mobility is going to be really nice, but you would have loved to see that that 1,000 gold streak plus the extra kill on the Sand King going the way of Kaka. As that would actually be a full-up Shivas for him, which makes a huge difference in a lot of these fights. DDC does have a Rod of Atos. What other items do we have here? As we are 30 minutes into this game, it has been one hell of a back-and-forth fest. Oh, goodbye. Goodbye, Zai.
Goodbye,
Zai. It's been nice. Lin is actually halfway to his Aghanims, and I like the just basic cloak to help him tank up a little bit more. We do have the Aghanims on Razor. I repeat, there is an Aghanims on Razor. I can see it. My caffeinated brain is fully aware of the Aghanims on the Razor. And that the fact that has been up. Blink Dagger and Force Staff for Demons. DDC has a Rod of Atos, and Clockwork just has a Force Staff and a Point Booster. For those of you who weren't here for Game 1, I may have missed the fact at some point in time during the game that Razor had an Aghanim. Because my brain was too slow. I am not a smart man. Shivas. Shivas, Shivas, Shivas. Aghanims for S. Pretty ha. Yeah, he did go for the Blink Dagger, of course. And Tidehunter again for the refresher. I think we've kind of outlined all the items that can be picked up for HGT. It's not going to be hard, apparently, for Centaur. He's going to be going for the BKB. Or, actually, Halberd. Let's see a Halberd. You've got both a Viper as well as a Razor. Both of those heroes are seriously harmed by a Halberd. Both the evasion as well as the disarm are pretty potent. I would love to see that item pick up on a Centaur Warrunner. I'm a big fan of the Heaven's Halberd in general, but I think here it makes perfect sense for a Centaur. His other option, of course, would be the BKB, just making sure he doesn't get bursted down by a lot of this magic damage from the Skywrath or gets disabled too much from Burrow Strikes and such like that. It is crazy to see how far ahead this Razor is ahead of the rest of the team. But HGT, they are taking both second, third, and fourth when it comes to the net worth, even if Razor is top of the board.
Dire's top tower is under attack.
The end result is actually the gold graph being very, very even. LV are just holding a bit of an experience lead, but that's it.
HGT, looking to try and push in this tier 2. I'm not sure if it's the greatest idea. They do have the Ravage up, while the Tidehunter, well, he's actually almost level 16. I'm kind of wanting to see the Aghanim finished up on the Ancient Apparition, because that is obviously a huge upgrade for them. And Kock actually went ahead and picked up a Reaver, so no Shivas. Instead, just went for the value plate mail. Can't be anything wrong with that one, that's for sure. And the increased tankiness of the Reaver is going to be made even better by all that extra armor on the Death Prophet. I wonder which one he's going to be finishing up first, though. If it's going to be the Shivas or the Heart, it's hard to say. Gem on Death Prophet as well. That was given over by Demons earlier in one of the earlier fights. So his loss is Kaka's gain, I suppose. I'm still feeling the LV have a better chance going into late game, but certainly all it takes when you have a Death Prophet on your team, and especially if you're controlling the map, as they are doing pretty well here, is that if you're just able to force one good team fight on the side, on LV's side of the map, and if you can win it, you immediately go into the base and take a tier 3 and maybe force some buybacks. ZSMJ, what you gonna do with this 2k gold you got in the bank? He's got an Ogre Club. What else does he build into? You've got IC also having that, well, part of the refresher built, just the Oblivion Staff for now, still only 1/3 of the way there right now. And the rest of LV are actually gonna try and go into do Roshan right now, up against a team that is well suited for defending it. So this is going to be one hell of a clash, and this could actually determine the whole entire game from here. HGT already settling up. IC's going to be on the front lines, looking to initiate with that Ravage, but LV are not actually going to be doing Roshan. We have Zyph on the left side, the rest of the team on the right. And Flame will try and push in this middle lane a little bit. It looks like HGT will just farm up the jungle together while they wait. As one team is going to go for Roshan here. The push is...
And it's off!
Actually, it seems like that. The push is actually going out here in the top lane, and the push is going in on the middle lane. So this is actually very favorable for LV, because if they simply just stall this game out, they've got access to the Ancients that they can farm up while they're waiting. So they're not necessarily missing out on a whole lot of golden experience, and these other lanes are pushing in. If they just go ahead and wait this out, eventually, HGT will have to back themselves up and defend. You can already see they went for the middle lane. Kaka throws out a couple of Crypt Swarms. That's the easy lane to defend, though. Roshan has already been brought down to half health. The top push just really isn't happening fast enough. It's going to start building some momentum soon. As soon as the Siege Creep dies, the Creep Wave will start moving along pretty quickly. But it looks like HGT are going to try and force it before then. They have a smoke right now. Roshan is getting low and sitting at 2,000 health. There goes the Ravage. Jump in from the Clockwork. It's going to be able to catch some heroes, but the Exorcism just gobbles him up. Skywrath Mage dropping the ultimate on the Centaur. Unable to do much there. And it looks like LV, missing a host of their abilities, are going to be losing out on this team fight. As they get themselves away from the Exorcism, this is going to be a nice little win. Double Force Staff forward, catches out Lin. The Silence on his ESMJ, not in time. Another Force Staff. Lin managed to get himself away. Lin, Iron Flame, Yule Scepter up, and an Ice Path. Beautiful! It's going to be able to hit on one hero there. Finishes off the Razor, the Viper, both going down. The Exorcism may be running out, but it doesn't matter. Roshan's low enough, but the rest of HGT will clean it up, and Aegis is finally going to go their way. Plus, they're going to push into the enemy base here, maybe force a buyback, though the only one that is up right now is on the side of the Sand King. So they'll push in the bottom lane, go for this tier 2. They can just keep on marching in if they want to. They can even just set up camp. Unfortunately, the top lane may end up causing somebody to go back here. Dire's bottom tower. But I was going to say, otherwise, HGT can actually just set up camp right in front of bottom and middle lane. And Dire's just go ahead and wait for Exorcism to be back up. Now, while the Razor is down for another 30 seconds, they are going to start beating on this tier 3 tower. With the Glyph up, it's going to make it a little difficult. And with the Viper as well as the Clockwork reviving here in a short amount of time. Still, though, they're going to get this tier 3. Maybe they can commit all the way for Rax. It looks like they're going to try to at least force LV to go into a fight 4 versus 5. Already the pipe has gone out. Icy. Losing his pipe effect, but it's already good enough. Whoa, the hook shot in. It's going to be able to grab CSMJ, but he gets bounced out of the cogs once again, and LV backing themselves up. They do successfully defend their Rax. That's all they wanted to see from that. Sure enough, they push into the top lane, will force Icy back. But look at how close this guy is to his refresher. That one team fight just pretty much determined the game. Like, LV have to claw their way back into this game because now with a double refresher up on LV, or excuse me, on this Tidehunter, they get a huge team fight advantage. We've got Kaka who can actually, does he have a Shivas? He does have a Shivas. We also have, I think that's actually Agonyms. There it is. Oh my God. You thought that last team fight looked pretty one-sided? If they execute as well as HGT did, oh, this is actually a bad start. CSMJ is going to be forced to use his BKB, gets caught in the cog, but forced staffed away. And now the Ravage goes off, actually hitting the clockwork on the side. Epicenter going off. They're going to try and go for Kaka, but he already has the BKB. So instead, he goes for the supports in the background, but it's not going to be good enough. Kaka chasing away Inflame. They need a little bit of extra damage. The Ghost should be able to finish him off, as Inflame is just not fast enough to outrun the dead. And HGT get the critical pickoff on the Racer, down for 80 seconds. Now they just five-man down mid. That's all that's left. Refresher can still be used here if they have some Arcane Boots. Doesn't look like they do, so Icy may just hold on to his Refresher, because even if he does pop it, he still needs an extra 325 mana for Ravage number 2. Lin, they're going to go straight into the back door, but they've already got Lin caught out. He's going to be forced to use his BKB, defend himself against that hoof stomp. Turns onto ZSMJ, but that guy is way too tanky. Now the stun. Oh, Ancient Apparition gets force staffed up the cliff and will be taken out. That was kind of the only hope there to dodge the Skywrath Mage ultimate. Now Icy is actually still caught inside the cogs here, and they're going to start focusing him down. Stampede goes for Demons on the left side. Kaka comes in, finishes him off with the Crypt Sword. Ice Blast over the top. Clockwork going to go in for Icy, getting low. Last Nuke might be able to finish him up, but the pipe will save him. LV trying to force back the rest of the squad of HGT. Another 20 seconds for the Razor to be back up, and LV successfully defend their racks once again. I really thought that was going to be HGT able to take this next one, but again, the lack of a Ravage here for Tidehunter is really what cost them control of that last team fight. But instead, they will still have the double Ravage up in just 45 seconds, plus another 10 seconds for the Death Prophet ultimate. And then you've got an Aghanim's upgrade for Ancient Apparition, Shivas, like all of these big upgrades. Meanwhile, LV, they haven't really made much in the last few minutes here. Especially due to the fact they've been dying, losing team fights, maybe even forced to use some buybacks here. For example, the Clockwork has been folding on to half of his Aghanim's for quite some time, but it hasn't really done much since the last purchase of his Ogre Club. And Inflame is tanky, but that tankiness can actually play against you somewhat. I see Ice Blast, especially with that Aghanim's upgrade, is going to be such a killer. ZSMJ on the front line, once again trying to focus, or at least force LB to focus on him as much as possible. Ravage is going to go out, Inflame in some trouble. Double Ravage goes out, and he's done for. No buyback from him, no buyback from the Viper or the Skywrath Mage. The Clockwork's going to fall in the background, and HGT. It was a long road, man. It was a long road with LV taking that game one, but they will finally secure this best of three over the course of the last 3.5 hours. They will be moving on in the Sina Cup. I really thought LV was going to be able to take it. I thought their performance in game one kind of showed that they had put together this new squad that looks really strong. They hadn't lost a game yet, but now they will up against HGT in this best of three. So that's going to be it for the Sina Cup for now. I believe we are now going to be hopping over to Vici Gaming versus the winners of this matchup, which means we're going to be heading over, or excuse me, Vici Gaming versus Lai. And that is going to be starting in an hour and 40 minutes. So I think we have a bit of a break, as I believe Toby is already done with his ESL 1 matches. So we're going to have a break until VG Gaming versus Lai. That is going to be casted by both Toby and I in the main studio on Join Dota Red. We're going to go through the VG Gaming versus Lai and then the loser's bracket round. And then Toby and I will separate once again while I cover the ESL 1 European qualifier. And Toby gets to do D2CL, which is going to be host to two really good matches, Navi versus Tinker, as well as C9 versus VP, while I'm doing X Game versus Denial to determine who gets knocked out of ESL. So thanks for tuning in, guys. We're going to be closing down Join Dota Blue, but we will see you guys over there on Join Dota Red in an hour and a half.